Hello, my name is Pastor Joel Silverman. Thank you for watching the Regeneration Church broadcast. It's my hope that through this message, you are encouraged and made stronger in Jesus Christ and the truth of His Word. Enjoy this message and may God richly bless you.
Amen. Those kids are way ahead of us, I'll tell you that much. They're not hanging around waiting for us to do whatever we're doing. Let's bow our heads before the Lord. God is so faithful to us. Father, we are a blessed people. We are a blessed people. We are a blessed people. Of all the people on the earth, we are a blessed people who know the Lord our God. Amen. And so, Lord, we just want to welcome you this day as we always do, Father. We thank you for the service. We thank you for all that's gone on, Lord, the worship, the communion. Lord, even all the messages, Lord God, about websites, Lord, and all the current activities that we have going on in the church. Father, we thank you for Regeneration Church. This is your church, Lord. It's your ministry. We thank you, Father, that you use it not only for this church and the people of this church, but you use it to bless all throughout Long Island. And so, Father, we just thank you for the opportunity and the privilege to do that. Lord, we pray for your anointing on your word this day, Lord. Let your anointing break every yoke off of us. And Lord, let your anointing, Lord God, speak into the heart of every man and woman here in Jesus' name. Amen. So if you remember last week, I started speaking on faithful living in turbulent times, and I'm going to pick up on part two today. But before I do that, because I just saw somebody I want to stand up. Josephine, stand up just for a moment. Now, I want to say something for this precious, not only young woman, but young believer in the Lord. She has started a Bible study at her work. Amen. Amen. So I want to bless the Lord for what He's doing in you and through you. It's going to be anointed, anointed. Thank you so much. We appreciate it. They started with three, I think you told me, but she has 10 that hopefully are going to join. Amen. In a school. Hallelujah. See, we're going to speak on boldness today and what the Lord wants us to do, that we need to be bold. We need to be courageous. That's a bold young woman. She's not just going by the law of the land who says political correct, which you can and cannot do. But she's saying, you know what, Lord, you tell me what you want me to do, and I'm going to walk in that. Amen? So we are going to speak again on faithful living in turbulent times. We're going to start with PowerPoint 2, which is just a reminder from last week that 2 Timothy 1:7 says, "For God has not given us the spirit of fear," but aren't you happy about that? "But of power, love, and a sound mind." And as believers in Jesus Christ, we spoke on this. Fear is never our answer. Faith is our answer. Faith. So looking again at our scripture in 2 Timothy, those words sound mind literally mean a mind that is protected under the blood of Christ. A mind that is protected because the word of God is going into that mind and it's being fed. It's a mind that knows the word. It's the opposite of a mind that is given to fear, panic, or unfounded or unreasonable thinking. We will feel fear at times. It's a normal emotion. I'm going to talk a little bit about it as we go on. But we don't have to live there. Amen? That's not our assignment in life. Thank God. So as believers, God has given us the sound mind, and we can think correctly about how to live even in these chaotic days. Even in days where everything seems up in the air and who knows what's going to be happening. So last week, we also spoke about 2 Timothy 3, which predicts these times we are living in are perilous times. I talked a little bit about that with the towers last week. The word perilous literally means something that is difficult, dangerous, or filled with risk. It is a prophetic warning out of the Word of God to let us know that those who live in that specific time are going to go through things for that specific time that will be different from anything that the earth has known before. And so let's look at a PowerPoint 3, 2 Timothy 3:1-5. Don't be naive. The word says don't be naive. There are difficult times ahead. As the end approaches, people are going to be self-absorbed. I say that's today. Money hungry, self-promoting, stuck up, profane, contemptuous of parents, crude, coarse, dog-eat dog, unbending, slanderers, impulsively wild, savage, cynical, treacherous, ruthless, bloated windbags, and my favorite, addicted to lust and allergic to God. That is the world today. The world is allergic to God today. Now look what the word says. They'll make a show of religion, but behind the scenes, they're animals. Interesting what the word says. Stay clear of these people. So God is saying, look, you're going to live in some serious times, and there's going to be very serious issues that are around us. We live in the world. We don't live in some far off planet. We're right here. But looking at that accurate description of our society today, how many of us realize we're going to have boldness and courage in the Lord? Jesus, Paul, David, Joseph, Mary, Elizabeth, the 12 apostles, all were bold. Their lives displayed their relationship with God. They didn't have a personal life and a public life like we've heard recently. Their life was their faith and their faith was their life. It was one and the same. It wasn't a certain face for a Sunday service or going to temple, but they lived their life. They literally had that life of faith. Being bold is having courage and speaking out against what's wrong, no matter what others think or say. It's doing God's will and continuing on the path He puts you on, regardless of what's going on around you. God has you on a specific path. He has all of us on a specific path. Sometimes that path intertwines together as we come together corporately. But all of us are walking our life in the Lord. And God has you there specifically because He wants you to influence people He's going to bring across that path of yours. No matter how you feel, no matter how well you're doing or how well you're not doing, nonetheless, God is going to use you. So we need to understand that godly boldness, not fleshly arrogance, comes out of confidence in God through Christ. We will not be bold if we do not have a close, intimate, active relationship with the Lord. We will feel like cowards many times. Let's look at PowerPoint. D.L. Moody, head of Moody Institute, once said, when we find a man meditating on the words of God, well, that man is full of boldness and is successful. Prayer in private results in boldness in public, said Ed Cole. Psalm 138:3, on the day I called out to you, you answered me and you made me bold with strength in my soul. So it's the word of God that connects us to boldness in the Holy Spirit. They are not separate from one another. The one produces the other. When we are not in the word of God, we become weak in the spirit, and we don't have that boldness. Why? Because we don't have that confidence with the Lord. So we have to understand all these dots connect. We don't have one thing and not another thing, but God compounds upon each of these characteristics to make us into the man or woman that He sees us to be. Okay. PowerPoint 5, it's our position in Christ that gives us the boldness and courage to do His will. Proverbs 28:1 says, the wicked man flees, though no one pursues, interesting, but the righteous, they are as bold as a lion. So what the scripture is telling us here is that when a person is operating in sinful ways or wicked ways, the scripture says, there is a fear that's attached to sinful behavior. Wouldn't we all say amen? When we are doing things the wrong way or we're doing things outside of God's word, you always have that feeling inside of you of uneasiness. Isn't that true? When we walk in our own selfish ways or our sinful ways, you always have that sense of kind of looking over your shoulder. Who's seeing? What am I doing? What if people know? Because the fear says to us, what if I get found out? So that's why the scripture is very clear that the wicked have that uneasiness going on. They don't have to. We can come to the Lord at any point. But they fear being caught or found out because it comes out of a guilty conscience. Remember, God uses the conscience in every person. Every person has a conscience. And before we even come to know Christ, God's going to use that conscience in every one of us to say, hello, hello, what are you doing? Where are you going? What are you living like? Because he's trying to draw us out of that darkness, which will be destructive to us and bring us into that kingdom of the Son of his love. But when we stand in righteousness, which isn't our own, but it comes through Christ Jesus, he has gained righteousness for us through his cross. And righteousness means I have right standing through the cross of Christ with God my Father. Through that blood, a way has been made for me. When people don't have that blood of Christ over them and they have not received Christ as Lord and Savior, God still loves them. He's still looking to draw them. But what happens is their sin is still standing before them. It is only the blood of Christ that removes that stain, literally removes that stain of sin. And so through Jesus and his cross, we now have right standing before God my Father. And guess what that gives me? A clear conscience. Amen. I don't have a guilty conscience that's going on. So my confidence now is stronger than it had been before because of what the Lord has done. This characteristic all believers should have no matter the circumstances going on around us. Remember, our confidence is where? In the Lord. Not in the external happenings of the world. Next PowerPoint. Boldness is defined, this is the dictionary, as our willingness to venture out and do the right thing at the right time, regardless of the barriers we may face. Do the right thing at the right time, regardless of the barriers we fear or we may face. What's the opposite of boldness? Hello, cowardice, fearfulness, cynicism, negativity, discouragement, and pessimism. We could all say amen. We've all gone through it. We all have it at times because it's in our natural flesh. So in the natural, we have all experienced negative feelings, every single one of us. Maybe they've been a big part of our life. Maybe they've really become our life. In other words, we so have wrapped ourselves around the negativity and the cynicism and the I don't know what's going to be, that it becomes a part of who we are. That's never what God has for us. In tenderhearted, we give the message all the time, feel your feelings, but don't make them facts. Now, for a lot of my own life, I made my feeling facts, and I believe most people do. But when we do that, our life is being driven by our emotions rather than being led by the Holy Spirit. For us to operate under boldness, whatever emotions I may be feeling on a given day, some days will be great, some days will be really negative, I have to bring those emotions to the Lord. Not pretend I'm not feeling them. We're not talking about I'm a Christian, I'm a stoic, I don't feel. Oh, yes, you do. Oh, yes, you do. And when you don't take those feelings to the Lord or talk those feelings out with the Lord, guess who gets them? People closest to you. See, emotions come out. We either take them out or we talk them out in a healthy, godly way. But your emotions will come out. And we say this so many times in tenderhearted, they come out when you least expect it. You know how you've built something up, a case about somebody, and you smile at them for 10 weeks in a row, and you see them on Sunday, hi, 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 hi. And then all of a sudden on that 11th Sunday, they do something, say something, and all of a sudden you have this reaction, as I like to call it, an outer body experience, where you're like, ah, is coming out of you. And you say to yourself, I can't believe I'm even acting like this. Pent up emotions.
That's right.
Pent-up emotions. Look, Jesus feels, God feels, we feel too. We have emotions. They're normal, they're healthy, but we can't let them drive or dictate who we are as people. So in the natural, we all experience the negative emotions. But remember 2 Timothy, our God hasn't given us a spirit of fear. They are out, the fears that come up out of our emotions. They come up out of our feelings. They are of our natural self. They may come even from fearful behaviors that have been passed down in our own families. Even circumstances, we would all say, occurring in the world today. You think of the word ISIS. You, my God, there's nobody you want to meet up with. But even family members that pass fears on one to another. You know, my Irish grandmother, as many of you know, lived with us in all my years growing up, my mom's mother. And she was a precious woman, loved the Lord dearly, but let me tell you, she had a lot of fears. And so one of her fears was thunder, and, you know, thunder and lightning in a storm. So if it was really thundering out bad, I can remember being very, very little. My mom worked in those years, and my grandmother minded my brother and myself. And when she saw a storm coming, she would gather us into her room, and she'd say, you know, we have to pray. And you could see the fear. As a little kid, I would say, my gosh, why is she so afraid? But it was just a natural fear. So, of course, we started to get very afraid. And I can remember at some point, you know, we were having a thunderstorm, and all of a sudden my brother and I were saying to my mother, you know, Mommy, we have to run. We have to run into Mun. We called my grandma. We have to run into Mun's room. My mother was like, what? What are you doing? So she says to my grandmother, what's going on here? Now, my mother was raised by this mother, this wonderful Irish mom. But my mother was the antithesis, because she said, I'm not going to come under this kind of fear. And my mother, believe me, was her own person. And so she would say to me, you don't have to be afraid of these things. Look, it's just this, it's that, you know. But those fears are passed on from one family member to the next, aren't they? Over anything, over everything. And we believe them to be truths. And that's where we make our mistake. We believe them to be facts. They are not facts. They are emotions. Now, maybe you're acting off of that in a way that can really be very destructive. But even in that, God is going to look to help you. You know, he understands. He knows each one of us. He understands who we are, how we've been raised, what has affected us, what hasn't affected us. And he looks to work with us in every and any one of those situations. So we need to understand God hasn't given us a spirit of fear. So when fear comes, we're going to talk about this. I need to be able to go to the Lord with it. All right, let's look at our next PowerPoint, 7. But to walk in boldness, we must first remember who we are in Christ Jesus. Acts 4:31 says of the disciples that after they were praying, the meeting place shook, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and then they preached the word of God with boldness. Once again, you see the connection between the word of God, the Holy Spirit of God, and boldness coming forth. So here they are having a wonderful prayer time and a prayer meeting to the Lord, and they're worshiping and praising God, which always draws the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit comes upon them, and now this boldness breaks forth on them. And boldness is just, you're going to do things outside of yourself. Amen. You're not going to be restricted in the natural ways where you may feel fearful or intimidated or unsure or inadequate. It's like God breaks through those barriers, and you just get lit on fire. And you're going to do what you've got to do no matter what's going on around you. So that's what was happening with them. They ran out and they preached the word of God with boldness. Now look, they knew the society they were living in.
Amen.
You think we have a hostile society? They had a hostile society. And yet, even in the fear, in the natural that they had, they didn't let that limit them. They felt the fear and they moved forward in their confidence in God and in the boldness that God was giving them to walk out their walk in Christ. Next one. So the first step to boldness is to remember what? Your position in Christ Jesus. Your position in Christ. That's where your security is. No matter who's telling you what or where, or you can't or you can, your position in Christ guarantees your security in Him. Look at the next one. You are a son or daughter of the living God.
Yeah.
That is the description of our life. It shouldn't be, I'm a this or I'm a that. Those are just things. They may be times or positions that God's going to walk you through, a certain season, a certain area in ministry. Your real truth is you are a son or a daughter of the living God. That is the place of your security. Other things come, other things go. It isn't your gifting that secures you. It is your position in the living God. You have to know that you have been cleansed through the blood of the Lamb. Now, let me say this. We all blow it at times. We all make mistakes. We get it. But we can go to the Lord immediately and say, Father, I'm asking you to forgive me. My heart is off. My reaction is off. My words are off. My attitude is off. Whatever it is. But we have a God we can approach because of that blood of Jesus that He has shed. The word literally says we can go into the throne room of God. The throne room of God. Think about this. That is the privilege we have. And in that place, find mercy and grace. The word says coming just when we need it. Hebrews 4, 15, 16. You need to know you have that access to God. On your job, you have that access. Riding in on the train, you have that access. In a moment, you have that access. I'm going to just finish this. You are justified, redeemed, and completely forgiven. A price for your ransom has already been paid. You know how I've preached on this? Amen. The price has been paid. That price that was hanging over your head that you would never, ever be able to pay. Jesus stepped in and said, I'm covering the cost here.
Amen.
Hallelujah. You talk about confident. And we are filled with His Holy Spirit. We are filled with this Holy Spirit, but we have to know who we are in the moment we are living in, and even with things that we may be going through, no matter whether it's society placing things on us, our own selves, our own heads, our own thoughts, where we go off, or whatever is going on, we need to know I have a position in Christ that no one can move me out of. No one. No one, no government can move you out of your position in Christ. Comes November 9th, we're going to be born again, washed in the blood, filled with the Spirit. Bottom line, who's in or who's out doesn't make a hill of beans, quite frankly, to my spiritual condition in Christ Jesus. Now, I have to make sure I'm telling that to my head and my heart and people around me, because people get frightened and they get unnerved. That fear crops up in a split second of time, fear comes up, and all of a sudden we find ourselves gripped with a fear. I'll share with you briefly, I had quite an incident I shared with my honey last night. I had gone out to a park in the afternoon, which I go and have a little bit of time with the Lord. As you know, it was a beautiful day. I was working on my sermon. And it was funny because as I drove into the park, it was rather empty. And I remember remarking to myself, that's kind of strange. It's such a gorgeous day. And this park has a lot of people in it. So I parked my car and I took out my little iPad and I'm working along, minding my own two cents. And all of a sudden, from this side of the parking lot, which I'm still in my car, in the parking lot. From this side of the parking lot, you hear tires screaming, screeching. that you went, oh, and you turned around, and here was a car from this side of the street, lunged over the curb, broke down signs, hit a tree, and started going around and around and around, forward, backward. Everyone was screaming. And I'll tell you, in a split second, because I wasn't that far away from this car, and the way it was accelerating and going, I'm crying out in my heart to the Lord, Jesus, Jesus, help me. In a split second, I didn't know, because this is how fast it was happening, should I get out of my car and run for it, because she was coming right down the road, or do I stay in the car and be protected? Because if I'm out of the car, forget it. This car was going all over the place. Now, thank the Lord, the person was not injured. Thank the Lord, no one, which is a miracle, was walking on the path. I just can't tell you how no one being there could only have been God. It could only have been God. There's children that play there, people getting out of cars. It's all these kind of paths diverge. And thank the Lord, the woman was okay. Now, whatever happened to her, whether she passed out, but she must have accelerated rather than hitting the brake. And that car spun till it literally hit a tree. And the car fell apart. The whole front end fell off and all that kind of stuff. But the point I'm making is, yes, thank you, Jesus. Here's the point. In a second, I'm crying out, Jesus, help me. In a second, do I go forward? Do I stay in the car? What do I do? That's how quick things happen. We all know this. And when it was done, all I could say was, Lord, thank you. Thank you for covering every person here. Not only me. No one else was injured. She would never lost consciousness. Whatever happened to her, she was okay. But, you know, the goodness of the Lord. And I shared with Pastor Joel when I got home. I said, you know, I stayed there for a while. And as I was driving home, I felt just a little nudge from the Lord. That every time I go into that park, I pray for that park and the people in that park, that it remain a peaceful, safe place. And do you know, I felt the Lord said, that was your prayers. That was your prayers. To him be the glory. See, we never know the things we're saying or doing that you think, oh, what's the big deal? In a selfish way, I pray for the park because I love going there and I want it to be a good place to go to. But here the Lord said, your prayers. Your prayers, because we have to know these things in the times that we are in. So let's look at that again. First step to boldness, remember your position in Christ. You are a son or a daughter of the living God. You have been cleansed through the blood of the Lamb. When we get to heaven, we will forever thank the Lord for the blood of the Lamb that covers the door of our lives. You are justified. God looks at you just as if you never sinned. Get that one. Think of those sinful things you did. And through the blood of Jesus is just as if you never did them at all. Redeemed, taken off the slave block. Redeemed, completely forgiven. A price for your ransom has already been paid. You are filled, hallelujah, with his Holy Spirit.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
What words? What words could we ever say? What words? Next one. Know your position in Christ and don't allow anyone or anything to take it from you. No person's opinion should ever supersede God's opinion of you in Christ, including your own opinion. You know how many times people will say to me in counseling, I'm just a loser. I'm no good. I don't do anything right. Not how God sees you.
Amen.
Not how God sees you. No person's opinion should ever supersede God's opinion of you, and not even your own opinion should do that.
That's right.
You were born to fulfill your destiny in Christ.
Amen.
Let me tell you, we all need an extreme makeover. The makeover needs to be who we really are in Christ Jesus, that we would really get it. We get a real brainwashing and get rid of the old junk that's in all of our heads and go forward in the Lord. Next PowerPoint. Secondly, confront your fears that tell you differently. Those fears that tell you you're no good, you're not going to make it, you can't do anything right. That is not of God. Fear always needs to be confronted with the Holy Spirit. If not, it controls us until we stand up to it. Listen, fear is real, as we said, for all of us. We all feel it. We need to turn our fears into prayers to the Lord. God says to me, when you feel afraid, I have fears just like you do, fear for this one, that one, what's going to be, what if? And the Lord says, just turn it around, make it a prayer. Make it a prayer. Don't hang on to it, because when we hang on to it, what do? I want to control it. Now I'm going to do something. I, the great Carol, will step in and control the circumstance. And as my husband would say, we're all running for our lives when that happens. But isn't that true? When we get afraid, we want to control, and we're sure I have the answer. And it really is the best answer, because it's my answer and you don't know what you're talking about. So this is what we need to do. It's how we all think. So we need to confront those fears. Fear always needs to be confronted with the Holy Spirit. If not, it controls us until we stand up to it. Think for a moment. How many fears right now in your life, honestly, between you and the Lord, have so much control over you? And you know why? It's not that we don't all feel these things. You haven't taken it to the Lord. You're trying to control it. You're trying to say, I'm going to do this, or I'm going to do that, or I know what to do. No, we don't know what to do. We need to ask the Lord. So we see our God speaking this to his servant Joshua. And interesting that my husband read the whole passage, PowerPoint 11. Joshua, in Joshua 1:9, the Lord says to Joshua, I have commanded you, haven't I? Be strong and courageous. Don't be fearful or discouraged, because the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Now, I want to explain this. You're going to see it in our next PowerPoint. The interesting point here is that God is not telling Joshua not to feel his feelings. God would never say that. He would never say that. We have to feel what we're feeling. But what the Lord was saying is, Joshua, don't be overtaken by those feelings. In reality, don't be taken out by your fears. Fear can take any one of us out of God's road that he has us on. It's a very powerful emotion. When you feel afraid, this is the translation. When you feel afraid, don't turn your back on it. God isn't saying don't feel. He's saying when you feel afraid, don't turn your back on it, but face it with the Holy Spirit. Go to God and say, Lord, I'm afraid of this happening or that happening or this situation or this person. I'm afraid. Own it. Take ownership of it. But go to the one who can relieve our heart of the fear. People cannot relieve your heart of fear. My husband is the best man in the entire universe. So cute, he just walked in the door. No. But he cannot relieve my heart of my fears. When I go to him and I say, honey, I'm afraid of this, I'm afraid of that. You know what he says to me? Let's pray. Let's pray. Because only the Lord can relieve our hearts. So when we feel afraid, don't turn your back on it. Don't pretend it's not there. Get real. Go to God. Say, this is what I'm feeling, and I need your help. So we need to go to God, and we need to trust him. We need to trust him. We all trust God in little bitty increments as we go through life. I really believe that, because anytime a new situation shows up, what's the first knee-jerk reaction?
Not in control.
we get afraid. So we have to learn now to trust him there in that situation as well. And God starts to build a foundation and build the trust. So we need to trust God, who will give us his power, same scripture out of 2 Timothy, which is the power of the Holy Spirit. It's not your power. You don't have the power to control things going on in your life. God has that power, but he wants you to go to him, to humble yourself, to let go of the need to control the situation and let God be God. You are not God. Hello? The position has been taken. Hello? So remember, thank God is right. Trust God, who's going to give us his power in the circumstance we're facing. And remember, he's not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, the power of the Holy Spirit, the love of Christ, and a sound mind. Now, let's look at our next PowerPoint. This is a good one. We're winding down. Someone has wisely said that courage is, number one, boldness in the face of danger. Two, it's steadfastness in the face of opposition. Three, it's action in the face of resistance. And four, it's optimism in the face of despair. Now look at the rest. The first one says, I won't be afraid. The second one says, I won't give up. The third one says, I won't be intimidated. And the fourth one says, I won't lose heart. Losing heart is going to be a big issue in the times that we're living in. Isn't that beautiful? Next PowerPoint, Hebrews 13:6 says, so that we may boldly come to the Lord and say, the Lord is my helper. I will not fear what man shall do to me. God is our helper. That is actually referring to the Spirit of the Lord himself, who one of his titles is what? Helper. Helper. He comes alongside of the believer. Only the believer. Only the believer has that privilege, that the Holy Spirit comes alongside of us and literally grabs a hold of us, secures us, keeps us standing firm, even when we feel we're sinking, we're falling, I can't go through it anymore. He secures us. And he holds on to us, and he starts to speak to us out of his word. And he will get you through whatever situation you are going through. He will not leave you to your own devices to try to figure things out. He says, I'm with you. I am God. Now let's look at our last PowerPoint. 1 Peter 5:8-9. The word says, keep a cool head. Stay alert. The devil is poised to pounce and would like nothing better than to catch you napping. Keep your guard up. You're not the only ones plunged into these hard times. It's the same with Christians all over the world. So keep a firm grip on your faith. The suffering won't last forever. It won't be long before this generous God, who has great plans for us in Christ, eternal and glorious plans they are, will have you put together and on your feet for good. He gets the last word. Yes, he does. Amen. Let's stand to our feet. God gets the last word. Amen. No matter what. Thank you, Father. We're living in a day and age of no matter what. To us, it's no matter what. To God says, I'm in control. Thank you, Father. The Lord is good to us. Amen. Let's just bow our head before the Lord. We'll have a worship song to end with. Father, we want to thank you because your word is truth. Your word is truth. And I pray for every heart here, including my own. Let us embrace your truth. Let us take your truth over all the things we're hearing on the news. Let us take the truth of who you are and whose we are in Christ Jesus over everything that's going on around us. Let us say, Lord, I'm going to turn off this media for a while, and I'm going to open up my Bible. Yes. And I'm going to sit before you, Lord, and I'm going to ask you to speak to my own heart. God is speaking. We have to quiet ourselves to hear his voice, not be taken in by all the voices around us. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, we just thank you that you are a loving, a kind, and a wonderful Father. But we also thank you that no matter what, you are in control. No matter what, you are sovereign. And no matter what, Lord God, on Wednesday morning, we're still going to be born again and washed in the blood, filled with your spirit, and have a future and a hope ahead of us because we are your children. And we thank you, God, in the name of Jesus, for what you are doing. In your priceless name we pray, Lord. Amen.
We hope you enjoyed today's message. If you would like to hear more, we encourage you to visit our website at regenerationchurchny.com. So if you're ever in the area, please stop by. We'd love to have you at our Regeneration Church Sunday service or our tender-hearted message. Again, we thank you for watching, and may God richly bless you.